बिस्मिल्लाह रहमान रहीम। टुडे द टॉपिक दैट वी आर गोइंग टू स्टडी इज कैल्शियम होम्योस्टेसिस इन द ह्यूमन बॉडी। एंड यू नो देर आर थ्री इम्पॉर्टेंट हॉर्मोन्स दैट आर रिस्पॉन्सिबल फॉर मेंटेनिंग द कैल्शियम होम्योस्टेसिस इन द बॉडी। दीज हॉर्मोन्स आर पर्टिकुलरली दीज थ्री हॉर्मोन्स, ऑल्दो वी हैव ऑल फ्यू मोर हॉर्मोन्स दैट आर ऑल्सो पार्टिसिपेटिंग इन द कैल्शियम होम्योस्टेसिस, बट द मेजर रोल इज प्लेड बाय parathyroid hormone, calcitonin, and vitamin D. My name is Talat Naz, and I am from Department of Physiology. Learning objectives are basically to study the distribution and role of calcium and phosphate in the human physiology, and regulation of blood calcium through the parathyroid hormone, calcitonin, and vitamin D, along with the synthesis of all these hormones, abnormalities of parathyroid gland. First of all, you know, calcium is distributed. So we have to study that calcium distribution and how it is balanced. So basically, when we talk about the calcium concentration in the ECF, it is about 9.4 milligram per deciliter or 2.4 millimole per liter. And you know, the main reservoir for the calcium is bone, which can constitute 99% of the calcium. 1% calcium is found in the cells, and means intracellularly, and 0.1% only is found in the ECF. But this 0.1% calcium maintenance, this is a range of the calcium that must be maintained. If there will be a minor difference in this 0.1%, the whole body functions will be disturbed. So bones and teeth has 99%, and extracellular fluid and cellular, they all collectively form about 1% reservoir for the calcium. And total body content is about 1000 gram calcium. If we further go in detail, we observe that, as we already told you, that 99% calcium is present in the bones. So out of 99%, 98% calcium is present in the form of hydroxyapatite crystals. So these crystals are basically giving a reservoir of calcium to the bones, and it is not so easy to exchange this amount which is present in the form of hydroxyapatite. So only 1% out of 99%, only 1% of the calcium is available as an exchangeable pool, means only 1% can be exchanged if there is low concentration of the calcium in the ECF. So remember, the calcium in the bone is in the form of hydroxyapatite crystals. So and 1% of the total body calcium is present in the cells, that we have already told you. 0.1% total body calcium is next ECF. So this is about how much calcium is distributed in the body in different compartments. Now in which form the calcium is present? So ionized calcium, means this Ca positive, is about 50%, and it is present as a free active cation and diffuses easily across the capillary membrane. This is basically from the 1%. This is basically from the 1% of the calcium, right? So out of this, 50% is present in the ionic form, which is basically known as the active form of the calcium. The other remaining calcium is protein bound, which is about 41%. Out of the 41%, majority is bound with the protein albumin. However, a few amount is also bound with the another protein, globulin. But this amount, that is 41% calcium, cannot diffuse across the capillary membrane because they are bound with the large size proteins. And the last one, the anion bound calcium, is also present, which is about 9%. It is bound to anion, negative ion molecules, for example phosphate and citrate, and this can diffuse easily across the capillary membranes. So this is from the Guyton and Hall. We have already discussed, and we have already read the role of calcium in the contraction of skeletal muscles in the first year. And most probably you have also studied the role of calcium in other types of muscles. So basically, calcium play a very important role in the contraction of skeletal, smooth, and cardiac muscles. It is also important for the blood clotting that we have studied during the blood module. and transmission of nerve impulse. So during when we were studying about the nerve impulse transmission, so the role of calcium has already discussed. So these are the major effects of the calcium. We will discuss this in more detail. The question arises, why normal concentration of calcium is important? And you know, if you are taking only a single example of the neuron, we find out that increased concentration of calcium, which is a condition known as hypercalcemia, because calcium is from the calcium. So hypercalcemia lead to progressive depression of the nervous system. Jaise hi calcium ka level aapki body mein increase hoga, it will lead to the depression of the nervous system. Depress kar dega nervous system ki activity ko. Agar normal se zyada high ho jayega. And if there is decreased concentration of calcium, it will lead to more excited nervous system. Most of the time, this concept is opposite in our mind, but remember, when there is decreased concentration of calcium, it will lead to more excitable nervous system. The reason behind is that when there is decreased concentration of calcium, the permeability for the sodium through the sodium channels will be increased, because we need a positive ion for the nervous activity. So in that case, in the case of calcium decreased concentration or hypocalcemic condition, there is a excited nervous system because of high permeability of sodium ions. It is also important to understand the phosphate distribution, because the bone is basically made up of a huge amount of calcium and phosphorus. So ECM phosphate concentration, the normal value is about 4 milligram per deciliter. Similar to the calcium, here also in the case of calcium, we have 99% calcium in the bones. However, for the phosphate, we have 85% phosphate is present in the bones. Cells contain 14 to 15%. ECF contain less than 1%, as similar to the calcium distribution. So both the calcium and phosphate are very important for the health or homeostasis of the bone. Body content tissue distribution, if we see this picture, we see that total body content for the potassium is 600 gram, and for the calcium we observe that 1000 gram. And relative distribution, percentage of total body content, bones and teeth 85%, extracellular fluid all collectively, because here in the cells we have high concentration of potassium, so it will cause about 50%. Over 80% phosphorus is found in the mitochondria, with 20% in the cytosol. And if we talk the inorganic constituent of the bone, so in this case, if we see the content, calcium is in highest concentration in the bone, 99%, and the second highest is the phosphate with 86%. And so on, the carbonate is 80%, magnesium 50%, sodium 35%, and water is 9%. So, is there any effect of the calcium and phosphate concentration in the body fluids? Means if there is change in the ECF concentration for the calcium or phosphate, then what will happen? Let's have a look. If there is change in the phosphate level in the ECF, if there is a sudden change in the phosphate level in the ECF, then what will happen? No major immediate effect of the body is observed. There may be slow and steady if this condition persists, but there is no major immediate effect. However, a slight change in the calcium level in the extracellular fluid can lead to extreme immediate physiological effects. What are these effects? Of course, we will study in coming slides. And in case if there is chronic hypocalcemia or chronic hypophosphatemia, greatly decreases the bone mineralization, it will weaken the bone, it can lead to osteoporosis and other conditions. Now come to the hormone, which is most important when we talk about the calcium homeostasis or the bone homeostasis, is the parathyroid hormone, which is basically released from the glands, parathyroid glands. There are four small glands located on the dorsal side. This is the dorsal side, back side of the thyroid. If you see, yeah, this is the front side. In this picture, I think you can observe this is the front side. And opposite to this, we observe that these are some yellowish brown ball-like structures. Small ball-like structures are present. These four are the parathyroid glands, and they produce parathyroid hormone. And the main function is responsible for monitoring the plasma calcium concentration and to maintain through its increased or decreased activity.
Part of the hormonal system, the parathyroid glands are almost exclusively responsible for the regulation of calcium levels in the bloodstream. Calcium is a vital nutrient in the body, used by every single cell for normal daily function. It's responsible for transferring messages between nerves, building bones, and so much more. If calcium levels are not exactly right, a variety of problems occur, including bone loss, intestinal symptoms, kidney disease, and mental disturbances. Long-standing elevation in calcium places a heavy burden on the body. Humans have four parathyroid glands. Because of their extremely important function to regulate calcium, they're the only organ in the body that we have four copies of. To regulate calcium, the parathyroid gland can release parathyroid hormone, or PTH, into the blood. To detect calcium levels in the blood, each individual parathyroid cell has a calcium sensor, which acts like a thermostat. When calcium levels are high, the gland shuts down and the PTH level decreases. When calcium levels are low, the gland produces PTH, which pours into the bloodstream. The PTH, or parathyroid hormone, eventually enters the bones and activates cells that reabsorb and remodel the bone, thereby releasing calcium into the blood. In addition, the hormone instructs the kidneys to absorb calcium back from urine. And finally, it changes vitamin D to its active form, which helps the intestines absorb calcium from food, thereby increasing the calcium in the blood. The majority of the time, parathyroid tumors are located in one of the four glands. A parathyroid tumor is, in most cases, a benign tumor that grows to an abnormal size. As it grows, it releases more parathyroid hormone, thus causing hyperparathyroidism. The tumor develops when there's a disturbance in the sensor on a single parathyroid cell. The thermostat level for the calcium changes to a higher number for that cell, while the remaining cells and glands stay at a lower, normal setting. As the calcium level rises, the normal parathyroid cells and glands shut down, while the abnormal cell continues to produce PTH. Just like muscles, cells that work multiply and get bigger, while cells and glands that don't get smaller. Gradually in time, the calcium level increases until it reaches the set point of the abnormal parathyroid's thermostat setting. Because hyperparathyroidism is caused by the abnormality in the sensor, the high calcium level will continue as long as the abnormal parathyroid tissue is present. This can lead to weakening of the bones due to continuous bone reabsorption and remodeling, causing osteoporosis and fracturing of the bone. High concentrations of calcium in the kidney leads to development of stones, which can affect the function of the kidney. High calcium levels can also cause the nervous system to become sluggish, leading to fatigue, memory loss, poor concentration, anxiety, and even depression. High calcium can even cause stiffening of blood vessels and high blood pressure. As with the nerves, it can cause sluggish conduction irregularities in the heart that can cause rhythm abnormalities and palpitations. High calcium in the intestines leads to acid reflux and constipation. Overall, high calcium levels are associated with a decreased life expectancy and increased chances of certain cancers, including colon, kidney, breast, and prostate. There is no effective long-term medical therapy available to treat hyperparathyroidism. Medications don't cure the problem. Parathyroid disease only gets worse with time. It will continually change and will not get better on its own. The only cure is surgery.
So we have a study that how the parathyroid hormone affects the calcium levels in the body. As you know, this is a peptide hormone that increases the plasma calcium. So basically how it works, it basically mobilizes the calcium from the bone, enhance the renal reabsorption from the kidney, especially the distal tubules of the nephron. They absorb the calcium, which is filtered out, and increases the intestinal absorption. So by these three modes, right, mobilization of calcium from the bone and acting on the renal tubules and acting on the intestine, it will increases the calcium levels in the ECF. And parathyroid is released from the chief cells in the parathyroid gland. Chief cells contain receptors for the calcium. Okay, you have to remember that calcium sensing receptors are present on chief cells of the parathyroid gland, and they sense the concentration of calcium. And if they find out a decrease in the plasma calcium level, they mediate the release of parathyroid hormone. And if they find out If the chief cell senses that there is a high level of calcium in the plasma, they inhibit the release of parathyroid hormone. So this is the bone, intestine and kidney on which the parathyroid hormone can affect and causes the release of calcium into the plasma. This picture will give you a very brief idea and help in the memorizing the concept. So basically consider that initially there is low level of calcium in your body. Okay, this is indicating the calcium level, and there is low calcium level. So this will be sensed by the chief cells of the parathyroid gland, which has the calcium sensing receptors. So what will happen? The parathyroid hormone receive a message to be released into the plasma. When it is released into the plasma, it will have a positive effect on the osteoclast, that is to break down the bone and release calcium into the plasma. It will have, parathyroid hormone has another effect on the kidney tubule cells, so that they will increase the calcium reabsorption, and it will also help in synthesis, increase the synthesis of vitamin D and convert the vitamin D3 into calcitriol, and in this way it will increase the level of vitamin D, which calcitriol, which is the active form of the vitamin D, act on the small intestine and increase the absorption of calcium. So in this way, these three effects, bones, kidney reabsorption and intestinal absorption of calcium, all this will lead to increase in the calcium level. So this cycle will be completed with the help of parathyroid hormone. So the other cycle we will discuss in coming slides, because the other hormone is the antagonistic hormone of the parathyroid, which is calcitonin. So it will discuss in detail in coming slides. So this is the calcitonin. Calcitonin is a hormone which is produced by parafollicular cells of the thyroid gland, which is also known as C cells of the calcitonin. So remember, calcitonin and C cells, calcitonin from the C's. So C is common in both, so you have to remember. This is so easy. Here you can see these are the follicular cells, which is basically responsible for the release of thyroid hormones, T3 and T4, and these small white, you can see these outside the follicle, we have some few cells, which is parafollicular cell. These parafollicular cells will release calcitonin, which participate in the calcium regulation. So what is the function of the calcitonin? It lowers the blood calcium. It is opposite to the parathyroid. Parathyroid will try to increase the blood calcium level, and calcitonin try to lowers the blood calcium level. So physiological effects are opposite to those of the parathyroid hormone. Calcitonin is rapid acting short term regulator of plasma calcium level, means this will have effect on the regulation of the calcium, but it will has a rapid action, and whenever there is rapid action, this is short term regulation. So, but anyhow, it will have an important effect on the calcium regulation, and it will try to lower the blood calcium if there will be high calcium. So what it will do, it will stimulate the osteoblast and inhibit. So basically, calcitonin stimulates the osteoblast and inhibit the osteoclastic activity. So it will help in the bone remodeling. Removal of calcium from the plasma to calcify the new bone, as well as the calcitonin lowers the plasma calcium by this process, that is bone remodeling. Of course, it will add up the calcium to the bones instead of increasing its concentration in the plasma. We observed that there is minor role in the adults due to parathyroid feedback. So in the adults, we observe that there is a high role of parathyroid hormone as compared to calcitonin. However, the major role is observed in the children due to the rapid nature of the bone remodeling. New bones are formed and their size is also increasing. So because of the bone remodeling, we observe the high role of calcitonin and its effects on the osteoclastic activity. And here you can see that the calcitonin is released from the thyroid gland, and then it will affect the plasma calcium. It lowers the calcium levels in the blood by all these methods that we have already discussed. And calcitonin inhibits the calcium absorption by intestine. Calcium absorption, you know, remember the calcium absorption in the intestine is increased due to the presence of vitamin D. So of course it will have somehow some effects on the intestine also. Calcitonin promotes the deposition of calcium into the bones, as we have already discussed, as well as it will inhibit the reabsorption of the calcium from the kidneys also. So this is how the calcitonin is working just opposite to the parathyroid hormone. Before we go for the vitamin D, this half part I want to discuss, because we have discussed how the parathyroid is working to stimulate or increase the concentration of calcium in the plasma. Now we have considered that we have high concentration of calcium in the plasma, then what will happen? This is similar to the parathyroid but in the opposite direction. So high level will stimulate the parafollicular cells of the thyroid gland to release which hormone? Calcitonin. This calcitonin will have a positive effect on the osteoblast activity, remodeling, and decrease the osteoclastic activity, so that more and more calcium will be deposited on the bone instead of removing. And then calcium, it will decrease, it has a negative effect on the calcium reabsorption. Of course, it will decrease the reabsorption of calcium from the renal tubules, and it will also have a negative effect in the vitamin D activation. So when there is decreased vitamin D, activated vitamin D, of course there will be decrease in the calcium absorption from the intestine. So because of osteoblastic activity, bone remodeling, because of the decrease the absorption of the calcium from the kidneys, and because of the decrease the absorption from the intestine, all these three factors causes in decrease in the calcium concentration from the plasma. I hope you understand this antagonistic activity of these two hormones which are regulating the blood calcium levels. Vitamin D is also a hormone, but it is not produced by any gland in the body. So that is why sometimes we consider that we never think about that vitamin D can be act as a hormone, but because after the formation it will enter into the blood and then it will go to the target through the blood, that is why it is also considered as endocrine hormone. So have a look how it is working in our body.
Vitamin D. We have two types of vitamin D have been found in the nature. Ergosterol, which is produced from the plants, which is a crude vitamin called as D2. And 7-D hydrocholesterol, which is a crude vitamin called as D3, found in the skin. And what are the sources? And the sources where it is formed in sun exposed to skin, and richest source is liver oil. And what about daily requirement? Adults require approximately 100 international units or 2.5 micrograms, whereas the pregnant as well as lactating mother needs 400 international units, and infants and children require 200 international units. Here you can see the metabolic pathway of the vitamin D synthesis. So here the vitamin D is synthesized in the skin from provitamin D3, that is 7-D hydrocholesterol, in the presence of ultraviolet light. And it is then hydroxylated to 25-hydroxycholecalciferol, which is also called as calcidiol, in the liver by 25 alpha hydroxylase enzyme. And it is finally gets converted into biologically active form of vitamin D in the kidney by means of an enzyme called as 1 alpha hydroxylase to form 125-dihydroxycholecalciferol. And finally, the 125-dihydroxycholecalciferol, which is a calcitriol, is called as active form of vitamin D. So what about the functions of vitamin D? It increases intestinal absorption of calcium as well as phosphate by synthesizing calcium binding proteins in the intestine. and it is also responsible for mineralization of bones mediated through osteoblasts. Rickets, seen in children, and osteomalacia in adults. So in rickets, there is inadequate mineralization of bone and it occurs before the closure of epiphyseal plate, typically in the children. And osteomalacia, where there is inadequate mineralization of the bone and occurs after the closure of epiphyseal plate and renal osteodystrophy in adults. So this is the difference between the rickets as well as osteomalacia. If vitamin D taken in larger doses, like approximately 500 to 1000 times of normal requirement for prolonged periods, so there are like immediate effects as well as delayed effects. So immediate effects are like thirst, anorexia, constipation, and polyuria, followed by nausea, vomiting, and diarrhea. And delayed effects, if you see, there will be hypercalcemia, urolithiasis, metastatic calcification, and sarcoidosis. And this is about vitamin D.
And in the previous video, we have already discussed about how the vitamin D is synthesized in our body and what are the different steps that will follow and the conversion of vitamin D from the inactivated state to the activated state. Here we will have a quick look that what happened if there is decrease, because we want to show you a relationship between parathyroid hormone and vitamin D. Although I gave you some idea, but I just have a quick review over here. So there is decreased calcium concentration, okay, this will lead to activate these calcium sensing cells on the parathyroid gland chief cells, and the chief cells will release the parathyroid hormone. This will act on the bone and calcium and phosphorus resorption occur, due to which the more and more calcium will be released and entered into the plasma. The other part it take is affect the kidneys, where 1-alpha-hydroxylase will be produced, that will affect the conversion of inactive vitamin D to activated vitamin D. So it also affects, it has to, and the another effect it will produce through the kidney is the calcium reabsorption, the calcium which was filtered out into the nephron, at the distal tubule, the calcium will be reabsorbed and enter into the plasma. So it also increases the phosphate excretion. Remember, the phosphate excretion is increased in the kidney, so that there will be decreased concentration of phosphate due to the presence of parathyroid hormone. So these are two effects, and after the 1-alpha-hydroxylase is produced by the kidneys due to the effect of the parathyroid hormone, this 1-alpha-hydroxylase will have a effect on 2,5-hydroxy vitamin D3, and then this will convert to 1,2,5-hydroxy D3, and then it will convert, it will have an effect on the intestine. As a result, calcium and phosphorus absorption will take place, and it will increase the calcium into the plasma. And if there is very high concentration of calcium because of all these factors, it will have a negative feedback effect on the parathyroid gland, that will decrease the concentration of calcium in the blood. In the beginning, I told you that not only these three hormones have an effect on the calcium concentration and body development related to calcium homeostasis, but the other hormones are also affecting, such as estrogen. Estrogen promote bone growth. When estrogens are reduced at menopause, we observe that there is a condition in the females, osteoporosis, which is, you know, there is a decrease the strength of the bone due to the removal of the minerals from the bone. And then we can have testosterone, which also stimulate the bone and cartilage growth. as well as growth hormone promote the bone and cartilage growth and increases the intestinal absorption of calcium. So basically we have a look on parathyroid hormone, calcitonin, vitamin D and 3, calcitriol, basically calcitriol, and then 1 to 5 dihydroxy vitamin D3 or calcitriol. And then we have estrogens, testosterone and growth hormone. These six hormones are found to have effects in the calcium homeostasis, but the major effects is due to the parathyroid hormone. Disorders of calcium imbalance, of course, if there is hypercalcemia, then we can have a quick look over here. Mechanism of hypercalcemia. Hypercalcemia may be due to increased bone resorption, increased renal absorption or decreased excretion, right, and increased gut absorption. These three can be the reasons for the hypercalcemia and the variables affecting the calcium metabolism. Now, why this can be happened? This can be happened because of the parathyroid hormone. This can be happened due to 1 to 5 hydroxy vitamin D and calcitonin. Calcium intake, maybe we can have an oral intake of calcium and phosphate, and then fibroblast growth factor. All these factors can enhance the calcium levels. Now, what are the target organs for the calcium metabolism if these factors can affect? So the target organs are bone, as we have already discussed, gut and kidneys. So all these three major systems that can be affected and the affected and can cause increased calcium in the plasma. This condition is known as hypercalcemia. Hypocalcemia can be due to the deficiency of parathyroid hormone or deficiency of vitamin D or both. So this is the main cause of the hypocalcemia. Calcium receptor deficiency. So in some diseases there is a condition in which receptors are damaged or may have autoimmune disorders that can make the receptors unresponsive. So that can be happened in the hypocalcemia. The conditions that are associated with hypocalcemia is one of them is the rickets. Basically, rickets is impaired metabolism due to the impaired metabolism of vitamin D. But of course, this is a condition in which there is hypocalcemia can occur. So in this condition, the rickets, there is softening of the bones in the children due to deficiency or impaired metabolism of vitamin D, phosphorus and calcium. So these phosphorus and calcium are also involved because of the lack of the calcium. As you know, the calcium is a reservoir for the bone. Because of the lack of calcium, rickets can be occur in the children's. Osteomalacia, as we have already discussed in the video, that osteomalacia is softening of the bones caused by the defective bone mineralization. There's a condition that hypocalcemia causes nervous system excitement and tetany. Hypocalcemia lead to increased membrane permeability. As I told you in the initial slides, that permeability for the sodium is increased. Severe hypocalcemia lead to tetanic muscle contraction and cause tetany. Hypocalcemia, okay, and causes seizures by increasing the excitability in the brain. Because there is excessive movement of the sodium ions, and you know, due to the excessive sodium ion entrance into the cell, the excitability of the cells will be increased. And the condition carpopedal spasm can occur. Tetany in the hand, which occur before tetany develops. First of all, there is tetany in the hands that can be developed. It's called carpopedal spasm. Tetany occurs when the blood concentration of calcium falls from 9.4 milligram, which is a normal concentration, to about 6 milligram or 5.5 milligram per deciliter, which is only 35% below the normal calcium concentration. So it will have a very high effect on the calcium metabolism and the blood concentration. So this is how the hypocalcemia causes the nervous system excitement and tetany in the body. Hypercalcemia depresses the nervous system and muscle activity. Increased calcium in the body fluid lead to the decreased QT interval of the heart. Decreased GIT muscle activity lead to the lack of the appetite and constipation. We have already discussed. This is just a go through it so that you can have a revision what we have studied in the previous slide. Depressive effects begin when the blood level of calcium rises above 12 milligram per deciliter. Okay, tell me. Excitement occur when the blood level of calcium decreases below which level? Give me the value. And we have studied this in the previous slide. Give me the answer. I am waiting. This is 5.5 to 6 milligram per deciliter. And what is the normal value of the calcium? It is 9.4 milligram per deciliter. Shabash. So you have to remember, increased calcium in the body fluid has lead to decrease QT interval, because these are the questions that can be asked in your question. Decrease QT interval of the heart, decrease GIT muscle activity, and lead to lack of appetite and constipation. So don't take too much calcium. So this is the summary of our today's lecture, that how the parathyroid hormone, vitamin D and calcitonin affects on the calcium homeostasis. I don't think I have to repeat this again and again, otherwise you say I am repeating. Just have a look on the summary. I hope you understand this very well. Thank you so much.